Well, good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing? And at least you guys, I know you sound very chatty this morning, so wide awake, ready to come and set your eyes on the Lord this morning. It's my hope. So anyway, my name is Blake Carpenter. I want to welcome you to Campus Bible. It's great to have you here this second service. For those of you who are here in person, as well as those who are joining us online. Yesterday, we had the great privilege of honoring all of those who help serve in the worship arts, who help serve on the worship arts team. And it goes way beyond than who you see up here. You know, this also includes those in the sound booth, the greeters, ushers, those helping out at special events like Glow and Jingle Jam or the Easter walkthrough, and so many people giving, and so many things going into all of these things to really bless us and edify us as a church. So it was a good time to honor them because we do so appreciate all of the work that they put in. This week, and even more so this morning, I think the Lord just impressed upon my heart the importance of what it means to keep our eyes on Him and how it's so important that we are intentional about that. Because if we find ourselves always being fixated on the day-to-day issues or social media or the news or just the corruption that we see in the world, we can become very discouraged. Because it is very discouraging to see what we see in our world. And it can cause us to enter a place where it is just dark, when we need to be the light. And the only way that we can be the light is if we allow Him to be the one to be the light in us. And we have to have our eyes fixed on Him in order to do that. And in Psalm 77, Asaph was going through the same things as he was seeing his troubles and the troubles in the world. And he said he found his soul in a place where it refused to be comforted. And it caused him to question the Lord's presence. It caused him to question the Lord's favor, His mercy, and His promises. And if we're the same way and have our eyes fixed on what we see down here in the world and all of the problems and issues, we're going to find ourselves in the same place. But as Asaph, as he goes on and writes in Psalm 77, he said he chooses to remember the days of old, and he chooses to remember the goodness and promises of God, the works of God, and how amazing He is, and that he would keep his eyes fixed on the Lord, so that He would be His light. And that's my hope this morning, is that we will do the same thing, even as it says in Colossians chapter 3. May we set our eyes on Him, fixed on Him, and our affections on Him, so that He can be our light. Amen? Let's stand up. Please pray with me before we get started into worship. Father, I pray that that's what we'll do, is that we'll fix our eyes on You. Allow You to speak to us. Allow us to see You more clearly. And that's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. You are the Lord. He's a famous one. You are the Lord, the famous one, famous one. Great is Your name in all the earth. The heavens declare Your glorious, glorious. Great is Your fame beyond the earth. Remembering all He's done, let's sing it out. And for all You've done and yet to do, with every breath I am praising You. Desire of the nations and every heart, You alone are God. Yes, He is. You alone are God. You are the Lord, the famous one, famous one. Great is your name in all the earth. The heavens declare your glorious, glorious. Great is your fame beyond the earth. Psalm 75:1 says, we give thanks to you, O Lord. We declare your wondrous works. Morning star.
The morning star is shining through, and every eye is watching you. Revealed by nature and miracles, you are beautiful. You are beautiful. You are the Lord, the famous one, famous one. Great is your name in all the earth. The heavens declare your glorious, glorious. Great is your fame beyond the earth.
Great is his fame. He is worthy of praise. He truly is. See the works of your hands.
I see the works of your hands. The galaxy spinning a heavenly dance. Oh God, all that you are is so overwhelming. And I hear the sound of your voice. All at once it's a gentle and thundering noise. Oh God, all that you are is so overwhelming. I delight myself in you, captivated by your beauty. I'm overwhelmed, I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I run into your arms, unashamed because of mercy. I'm overwhelmed, I'm overwhelmed by you.
I know the power of your cross, and I know the power of your cross. Forgiven and free forever, you'll be my God. All that you've done is so overwhelming. I delight myself in you, in the glory of your presence. I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I run into your arms, unashamed because of mercy. I'm overwhelmed, I'm overwhelmed by you.
How beautiful he is. You are beautiful, you are beautiful, oh God. There is no one more beautiful. You are beautiful. God, you are the most beautiful. You are wonderful. You are wonderful. Oh God, there is no one more wonderful. You are wonderful. God, you are the most wonderful.
You are glorious.
You are glorious. You are glorious. Oh God, there is no one more glorious. You are glorious. God, you are the most glorious. I delight myself in you, in the glory of your presence. I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I run into your arms, unashamed. Mercy, I'm overwhelmed by you. I'm overwhelmed by you.
He's the light of the world,
light of the world. You step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life made with you.
So here I am to worship.
So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
King of all days,
King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all full of sake became poor. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Sing it out, and I'll never know how much it costs.
And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross.
To bow down.
Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Sing that one again.
So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
You are wonderful to us. As we remember who you are worthy of all praise. You are King of all. We thank you for this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Hello, whoever that was. It is great to see all of your bright, shining, smiling, happy faces. I see a few more maybe smiley faces on the parents in the audience than normal, possibly because your kids are going back to school, which is a good thing. Maybe a few less smiles on the faces of the actual kids, though. I'm just kidding. We parents love our children, especially when they're not around. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Mark Tremaine. I'm the junior high director here at our Maple campus because I lack the maturity to do any other job around here. It is my pleasure to give you guys some announcements this morning. If this is your first time with us at Campus Bible Church, we want to extend a friendly welcome to you. In the back of your seat, you'll notice some connection cards. We'd love to get to know you a little bit if you'd like to fill that out and drop it either in the offering bags that go by or in the box at the back of the auditorium. If any of you guys have prayer requests, questions that you would like to ask the elders or staff, just not me, you're welcome to fill those out as well. And if you are new to campus, I'd encourage you after service to go out and check out our information center. We actually have a welcome gift for you there. To thank you for coming and worshiping with us today. We would be happy to answer any questions about our church, our ministries, the things that we have going on. And we're just really glad that you're here. Speaking of things going on, a couple of things that are going on in the life of our church that I'd like to bring to your attention. First is a special presentation happening tonight at 6 p.m. in this auditorium about a project we call Air Jaren. Jaren Ministries, which is headquartered here at campus, invites all of you to join us tonight for a special evening to learn about how God is using technology to broadcast Pastor Jim's messages into places all over the world. We've been broadcasting Pastor Jim's messages over digital shortwave radio into Asia primarily, using some cutting-edge radio production and translation technology to get biblical teaching and discipleship training into places where it is desperately needed, some of the most spiritually dark places in the world and where other Christian media is restricted or controlled by the government. So we would love to share with you guys how God is using Pastor Jim's life work to impact Christians all over the world. You'll get to hear from Pastor Jim, from myself, our radio engineer, Darren Alvord, Director of Ministries, Rob Carter. And if that isn't enough to convince you to come, we will also have a light dessert to follow. So if you want to suffer our presentation, we will, in fact, feed you afterwards. That's happening tonight at 6. Finally, our growth groups are starting up again the week of September 8th. The list of groups is posted on the church website. We also have signups on the table out there. Growth groups are a really great option if you're looking to experience some of that Christian community that is so valuable to our walk with the Lord. I remember growing up, my parents hosted a growth group in their home, and the couples that participated in that went through the ups and downs of life together, and that was really cool to get to see. So I'd encourage all of you, if you haven't thought about it before, growth groups are a great way to just find Christian fellowship and just encouragement for everything that life throws at us. With that, I'd like to invite the men to come forward as we prepare to give this morning's offering, and I will pray to cover them as they walk down the aisle. Father, I thank you for this time that we can come together, just for this branch office of the body of Christ that is Campus Bible Church, for all of the things that we have going on, for every man, woman, and child represented here in this audience, just the different ways that you're at work in each and every one of our lives. We ask your blessing on this morning's offering, that you would continue to provide for our church, provide for all of our needs as well. I ask that you would be with Pastor Jim as he preaches this morning, that you would give him the boldness and courage to preach from your word, give him the right words to say, that we as the audience would have ears to hear, that we would be receptive to just the proddings of the Holy Spirit. And we ask that all of us would go forth from here empowered to live lives that honor you and that love and serve those around us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Of glory coming on the clouds with fire, the whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see his love and mercy washing over all our sin. People say, the people say, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Please stand as we sing.
I see a generation rising up to take their place with selfless faith, selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and seek. We're on our knees, on our knees.
Hosanna,
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Heal my heart, make it clean.
Heart and make it clean. Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I am for your kingdom's cause, as I walk from earth into eternity.
Sing it out, Hosanna.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Hosanna,
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
So we do say Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. You are King of all, in Jesus' name, amen. Before you are seated, please take a moment and greet one another.
Well, praise the Lord in the house of God. Amen. We have an absolutely full house today and many people watching online. Let's give the Lord a hand today for this beautiful day. Good morning to all of you. Well, I just returned from a study tour in Italy and Greece, and there are some rumors out. The first rumor is that I fell down and hurt myself. And then while the ambulance was coming, somebody pickpocketed me. And then Athens burned. Well, all those things are true. I did fall down. There was no ambulance. And secondly, Athens did burn. Because the guy that stole my pickpocket, I think, was right in the center of that. I'm not sure, but I just want you to know everything is fine. And I got my stuff back. My credit card eventually was replaced, and I'm good. Some of you might want to take me to lunch. That would be nice, but... But the one thing we learned while we were studying is that a lot of tragedies affected human history, whether it was wildfires or earthquakes, not just the conquering of other nations. Well, I want you to turn with me to Matthew chapter 21, because what's interesting is we find in human history that what men build, God often allows natural disasters to destroy. In Matthew 21, we're going to consider a familiar account of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. We're going to find out it wasn't so triumphal, because just days later, he'd be crucified. And this, too, would be an event that changed human history. Now, as many of you know, I'm going to be the senior pastor only for about 4 more months, and then I'll be an associate pastor here, serving part-time here and part-time at Jaron. And I want you to know that I'm changing my files, probably the most complicated part of moving and adjusting after so many years of ministry here, almost 30 years, is my files. Well, in my files, I have a copy of a 1906 San Francisco Examiner. I collected old newspapers many years ago. And the newspaper headline summed it up when it said, "Earthquake, San Francisco in ruins." Those of you in the auditorium can see that as well on screen. Well, today in the study of Matthew chapter 21, we're about to be reminded of another event that literally stirred up a whole city, actually a whole nation, actually the whole world, and we are here talking about it so many centuries later. This time, the city is not San Francisco, but Jerusalem. This time, it's not 1906, but around 30 AD, maybe even 33 AD. The event is not an earthquake, but a simple man riding on a small colt into a city on a young donkey. Listen to me. To some, it may have been uneventful. Certainly not compared to a wildfire, certainly not compared to an earthquake, and yet that one event would change the course of history. How could that be? That's what we're here to find out. Would you take out your study outlines, please, and turn to Matthew chapter 21, and let's talk about the impact of the man who shook up the world. Now, to help our understanding, we're going to do a synoptic study today. That means we're going to look at Matthew 21, verses 1 to 11, Mark chapter 11, verses 1 to 11, Luke chapter 19, verses 29 to 44, and even John chapter 12, verses 12 to 19. So we're going to do a synthetical study, certainly focusing on our verse-by-verse study of the Gospel of Matthew, but going beyond that to the other three Gospels. And we begin with the account of the return of the king. It's Saturday, 6 days before Passover, you know, that celebration of God's deliverance of the people of God after 430 years of bondage in Egypt. So Jesus and his 12 disciples are spending a quiet Sabbath in the small town of Bethany, about 2 miles southeast of Jerusalem. They're staying in the home of a man by the name of Simon the leper, obviously one who Jesus had healed. With them are his intimate friends, Mary and Martha, and of course, Lazarus, who Jesus also has just raised from the dead. So word spreads that Jesus is in Bethany, and he's with Lazarus, and both of them are very much alive. John chapter 12, verses 9 to 11. And a great number of Jews crowd into Bethany to see Jesus and Lazarus, and the chief priests are not very happy about this, and they had already plotted to kill Jesus. Now they added to their plot to kill Lazarus. Why? Because Jews were believing in Christ because of Lazarus' resurrection. If your good friend dies and 4 days later, he's raised from the dead, I think it would get your attention, don't you think? And there goes Jesus' quiet Sabbath. So the next day is a Sunday, and Jesus and his disciples leave Bethany. They walk about a mile and a half over the sloping hills of the Sea of the Mount of Olives toward the town of Bethphage. It's a village on the road going east from Jerusalem and points to Jericho. But just outside the village, Jesus directs two of his disciples, some suggest it's Peter and John, we don't know for sure, to Bethphage. Listen to the account in Matthew 21, verses 1 to 7. And when they had approached Jerusalem and had come to Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied there and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord has need of them. And immediately he will send them. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, gentle and mounted on a donkey, even on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. The disciples went and did just as Jesus had instructed them and brought the donkey and the colt and laid their coats on them, and he sat on the coats. Now, we know at this point in the narrative that Jesus has something very special in mind. Listen to the prophecy of Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, quoted here in Matthew 21, verse 4 and 5. Don't miss the key words to this passage. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. Now remember in our verse-by-verse study of Matthew, up to this point, Jesus has been relatively quiet. In fact, every time he does something marvelous, he'll tell his disciples and even those that he heals, don't tell anybody, because the timing isn't right. But now it is. There might even been, if you will, if we were doing a movie, a drum roll, some change of music, some change of scene. Jesus, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, is now ready to present himself as to who he is. And it was a time in Zechariah's prophecy for the people of God to rejoice, to shout, and to look at Jesus. Boy, is that not a great thing to say before you enter your worship set on a Sunday morning? To rejoice, get ready to shout, and let's look at Jesus. I hope you're doing that today. Now go back to the story. Matthew 21 now, verse 6 and 7. The disciples went and did just as Jesus had instructed them and brought the donkey and the colt and laid their coats on them, and he sat on the coats. So the two disciples go into Bethphage, and they get two donkeys, a mother and, if you will, a young colt. And immediately the disciples throw their garments on both the donkeys, with the mother donkey probably in front to lead the colt. And a lot of pictures, a lot of movies, a lot of depictions will say, oh, wasn't Jesus humble at this point? This was such a great sense of humility that he's riding on a donkey, a colt, and not a white horse like some king. But that's not the way it was. In fact, riding on an unridden donkey colt was not a sign of humility or poverty. It was a sign of peace. Now, don't miss this, because here was the Prince of Peace coming into a city named for peace, Jerusalem, shalom, wholeness, entirety, peace. This was the city that was supposed to, if you will, produce the one who would produce peace in our hearts and our lives. Now, go back to the account. Because by this time, the crowd had gathered in Bethany the day before, and they had heard that Jesus was now in Bethphage. And so what do? They did what they did up in John 6 and other places. Remember up north in Galilee, when every time Jesus did something amazing, what would they do? They chased him. Now, they weren't chasing him because they were interested in worshiping him. They were chasing him for the goodies that he would give, the healings, the bread, the raising of the dead, and even the hope that he would become their king and deliver them from bondage in Rome. But Jesus had another plan. So they arrive, And they see Jesus on the donkey, and they begin spreading their garments on the road in front of the animals, not on top of the animals that the disciples did, but now in front, forming a soft carpet of clothing. Don't miss the imagery here, because it plays into the story of Jesus' response. So here we have Jesus in front of the crowd, and they now head down the steep slopes of the Mount of Olives off towards Jerusalem. If you've ever been to Israel and been to that road, it is extremely steep. I had to use a railing to get down. I can't even imagine riding on a horse or a donkey or a colt going down there. I mean, it's an decline like that. But during this time, Jerusalem and the surrounding towns are packed with visitors who had come to celebrate the Passover and visit the temple. Every Jew that lived within 15 miles of Jerusalem was required by Jewish law to come to the Passover in Jerusalem. But then we had Jewish families from all over the known world who would also come. And I want to give you a little bit of data because it's important to the story. You see, in Jesus' day, Jerusalem was only about 25,000 people. Now, remember, Rome was 1 million people. So it's only a very small town, if you will. But historians tell us that there was about 2.5 million people that came to the Passover that year. How did we get that figure? It didn't pull it out of the air. Historians tell us that there was a census taken on the number of lambs that were slain at the Passover that year. The number given was 256,000 lambs slain. Now, I want you to understand the pathos of this. That many lambs slain would have been pourings of blood and water down through the pipes from the temple across the Kidron Valley that Jesus crossed. Remember, the Bible talks about the blood and water that came out of Jesus. So he's crossing a river filled with blood and water on his way to the entry into Jerusalem. There's a whole sermon there. 256,000 lambs. Now, Jewish law required that one lamb was to be eaten by no less than 10 people. So do the math. 2,560,000 people would be the number. That's why Josephus, the historian, estimates 3 million celebrating the Passover that day. It's a lot of people in a town that houses 25,000 people. So as Jesus and the crowd from Bethany are traveling toward Jerusalem, a great throng of these visitors to Jerusalem get word of what's happening and come out to meet Jesus. And so they head toward him. They're coming down the road, cross the Kidron Valley, up to the gate where they enter, probably in the southern steps going up there. We've been there many times. And now you got the crowds from Jerusalem coming down. Only they don't put their coats off and put it on the donkey or on the road. They start cutting branches from olive trees and fig trees, and they lay them on the road ahead of Jesus all the way to the gates of the temple. So now you have two streams of people, the crowds from Bethany with the disciples and Jesus behind him, and the Jerusalem crowd ahead of him. And they converge outside the city, and they head toward Jerusalem together. And that makes us understand verse 8 and 9 in Matthew 21 now. Most of the crowd spread their coats in the road, and others were cutting branches from the trees and spreading them in the road. The crowds going ahead of him and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." That's Matthew's record. But if you get all four Bible accounts in the Gospels, it is a cacophony of shouting and cheering and screaming, kind of like being at a football stadium during a touchdown. Hosanna, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who is coming in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest. The noise, the excitement, the emotion. But don't be fooled. These were not cries of worship or adoration of the Son of God. These were the cries of a people in political bondage. There were cries filled with appeals to God to save them from Roman rule and provide their every need so they wouldn't have to work. The word Hosanna doesn't just mean save. It means save now. It's exactly what they were saying. Get us out of here, Lord, and do it now. And too many in that crowd were really attending a political rally. Not a time of worship and adoration. There were some. Daniel's prophecy tells us there were people who did respond to the healings and the miracles that the Messiah did and responded to him as Yeshua HaMashiach. We get that, but not many. Not many. Don't even get me started on the rallies during this election year, where people are dividing by political party and presidential candidate in hopes that they will save America. Might I tell you, that's not my hope. I don't care how you vote. It's not my hope. My hope is on the return of the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. How many of you believe that? Raise your hand. But the story isn't over, because amid the shouting of the crowds, so ecstatic stood the critical Pharisees. Oh, they had heard the shouts, and it seemed blasphemous to their unbelieving hearts, and they cry out to Jesus, "Teacher, Rabbi, rebuke your disciples," Luke 19:39. In other words, how can you let these people do this and treat you like the Messiah, the Son of David? Now remember, up to this time, Jesus had been relatively silent, even toward the Pharisees, right? In fact, one might say he was rather gracious, but those days are over. In fact, in the midst of the shouting, this cacophony of sound, Jesus shouts above the crowd, and I would have loved to have been there, and says to them in Luke 19:40, "If these become silent, the stones will cry out." And guess what it did? It silenced the Pharisees for now. A few days later, they'd be shouting, "Crucify him, crucify him." But for now, he had silenced them. So he enters the city of Jerusalem, and we pick up a third crowd shouting, namely the inhabitants of Jerusalem. Maybe a part of the 2.5 million, or perhaps even a part of the citizenry of 25,000 that lived in Jerusalem year-round. We don't know. The Bible doesn't say. But Matthew 21 mentions this in verse 10 and 11. When he had entered Jerusalem, all the city was stirred. Now, why would Matthew say all the city? Because there was a lot. Saying, "Who is this?" And the crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth, and just up north in Galilee." Jesus then heads directly to the temple. Imagine the hustle, the bustle of thousands and thousands of people trying to get their sacrifice in before sundown. And Jesus enters. This time he's silent. He looks around without saying a word. And in sadness, he sees the sea of humanity. Mark 11:11 tells us it was now late in the day. I wonder what Jesus' thoughts were, don't you? They were saying, "Who is this?" He might have been saying, "Who are they?" Apparently, Jesus stays in the temple for quite a long time, enough time for the crowds to disperse, and he leaves Jerusalem that evening with his 12 disciples, travels a couple of miles back to Bethany where they spend the night. But the story isn't over. Oh, in the movies, it's over. Oftentimes in our Bible stories, it's over. It's not over. Because the very next morning, the Monday, Jesus returns to Jerusalem, and on this way, he curses the fig tree and goes into the temple. And this time, he's not silent. In fact, next week, one of our pastors is going to look at verse 12 of Matthew 21 and following. For the second time, at the beginning of Jesus' ministry and now at the end of Jesus' earthly ministry, he's going to turn the tables on those that would turn the temple into a den of thieves and a house of robbers. And the Bible says zeal for God's house consumed him. The Son of Man was ticked. He didn't go in there and say, "Hey guys, would you mind not doing this anymore? Please, pretty please." He was consumed with the righteous indignation of an almighty and a holy God and spoke accordingly. We'll cover that next week. But back to our story. Because that Monday evening, he again travels back to Bethany, stays the night there. You know the story. The next 2 days, Tuesday and Wednesday, he returns to Jerusalem, again to the temple. He teaches the people, confronts the scribes. On Thursday evening, he participates in the Last Supper with his disciples. That night, he's arrested. On Friday, he's tried, crucified, and buried. And on Saturday, he's still in the grave. But on Sunday, he gloriously rises from the dead. The King is alive. Say that with me. The King is alive. But I want us to consider the responses of the crowd. If you're a reporter and you're walking in and you just go, so where are you from? I'm from Bethany. I'm from Bethsaida. I'm from Jerusalem. I'm from, you know, Ethiopia. Traveled all this way. And you're a reporter. Well, what did you think? All kinds of different responses to this day. We have them recorded in the scriptures. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all record different responses. You put them all together and you get this marvelous symphony, if you will, of responses. Matthew 21, verse 10 and 11, when he had entered Jerusalem, all the city was stirred, saying, who is this? And the crowds were saying, this is the prophet Jesus excuse me, from Nazareth in Galilee. Do you remember when Jesus is up north in Tel Dan in the area of Caesarea Philippi, and he says to his disciples there, remember on that rock face where he's looking at the hole, the mouth of Hades, and he says to his disciples, so what are people saying about me? Who do people say I am? So here he is now with the people saying, who is this? And he goes to his disciples, and all four Gospels give us the responses. Let's go briefly through these. First, to the throngs of Passover pilgrims. No, the 2.5 million, or at least a part of them. He was the Savior. Don't miss this. His name was Yeshua. They got that. They knew what Yahshua meant. The Lord saves. And they even shouted, Hosanna! Right? Declaring with their words that he's the one who saves, but they wanted a different kind of salvation. There's not a person in this room that doesn't need salvation from something, but not necessarily what God says we need to be saved from. And some of that Passover crowd also said he's the blessed one, the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Now, you go back to your old black and white movies with cowboys and Indians, and you remember the sheriff would say, stop in the name of the law. Remember that? He wasn't the law, he represented the law, right? Well, when I was there in the Colosseum just days ago, I reminded the crowd before they went in about the story of Telemachus. You can look it up. You see, the Colosseum was a death place, a blood sport place for 350 years. And there was a young Christian who was tired of the blood, who was in the crowd that day watching his fellow Romans and citizenry just cheering the blood sinking into the sands of the Colosseum. And he jumped out of the stands into the sand right there where the gladiators are fighting, and he said to the crowd, stop in the name of the Lord. He turned to this other side and said, stop in the name of the Lord. And a gladiator took out his sword and killed him on the spot, and his blood poured into the sand. And the crowd got silent. True story. You can read about it. And they left the auditorium that day, and on that day was the last killing in the Colosseum, because a man would stand and say, stop in the name of the Lord. And here's Jesus coming into a city, and they recognized that he was coming in the name of the Lord to stop the consequence of sin and death and to conquer it. Somebody say amen. Amen. Because he was the blessed one. But those crowds also said and recognized that which was true, that he was the King of Israel. He was the one promised in 1 Samuel 7 and other places. We call it the Davidic covenant, where God says to King David, your house and your kingdom shall endure before me forever. Your throne shall be established forever. But they weren't interested in a heavenly kingdom. In a heavenly king. They wanted the descendant of David. Who doesn't want one of their own? He's blood. But they wanted a Messiah who would deliver them from their earthly troubles. They had no use for a personal savior. They wanted the national hero that was their blood. They wanted someone to applaud, not necessarily someone to rally upon, or rely upon, rather, for their eternal future. Does that not sound familiar to the world in which we live? What kind of Jesus are you looking for? What kind of savior do you want? I want somebody to save me from my financial troubles. I want a Savior that can secure Social Security. I want a Savior that will do this or that and just add all the political platforms on either side of the camp. Many of us are so focused on things of this world, we have no time to consider our need for a real Savior. It offers what we really need, even when we don't see it or admit it. Well, let's move on to a second group's response, and that's his own disciples. We don't find this in Matthew's gospel. We find it in John's gospel, chapter 12, verse 16. And you know what? This whole thing was a mystery. A mystery. I suppose I could talk about some of the mysteries around this story. And look, some pastors like to talk about the mystery of why donkeys have a cross on their back. Okay, that's not the mystery I'm interested in. I'm interested in the response to, who is this? This mysterious man who heals the sick and raises the dead and can save men's souls. John 12, 16, these things his disciples did not understand at the first. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written of him and that they had done these things to him. See, they hadn't figured out who he really was. Remember? Jesus said, I gotta die. And Peter says, no, that'll never happen to you. And Jesus said, get behind me, Satan. They hadn't figured out yet that Jesus needed to die to save men, that there's no other way we could ever reach heaven except for his sacrifice days later. There's a third group, and that's the multitude from Bethany, remember? The ones that witnessed Lazarus as being raised from the dead. He was a miracle worker, Luke 19, John 12, and in other places as well. John 12, 17 says this, so the people, watch this now, who were with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead, continued to testify about him. No applause due because of the next verse. For this reason also, the people went and met him because they heard that he had performed this sign. Verse 36 says, and while Jesus said, while you have the light, believe in the light so that you may become sons of light. These things Jesus spoke, and he went away and hid himself from them. But though he had performed so many signs before them, yet they were not believing in him. That's hardly worthy of this. Those that saw Lazarus raised from the dead. There's no question Jesus was fascinating. That he performed marvelous miracles, signs and wonders. Many unbelievers believe that. You ask him who one of the greatest teachers in the history of the world was, they'll say, Jesus. Who is one of the mysterious, amazing people performing marvelous things and signs and wonders? Jesus. But these people in Bethany, just like today, were more interested in what miracles Jesus could do for them than who he really is. Because the King of Kings and Lord of Lords is worthy of adoration even if he does nothing for us. I don't think many of us believe that. But then from our main text in Matthew 21, we consider how the regular, everyday inhabitants of Jerusalem felt. Let's look at the citizens of Jerusalem, because to them, Matthew 21 says he was a prophet. And before you applaud, let me show you the text as it was written. When he had entered Jerusalem, verse 10 and 11, all the city was stirred, saying, who is this? And the crowds were saying, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee. Not the prophet. Remember in John chapter 4 when the woman at the well was blessed by Jesus and she says, I perceive that you are the prophet, not a prophet. Not one of many prophets, you're the only prophet. In fact, the Samaritans believed there's only one prophet that would come back, and that'd be the Messiah. She got it. They didn't. He's a prophet among many prophets who happens to be also a man, just a man. And again, verse 10 and 11, this is the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. No, this was the one sent from heaven. It's certainly true that he was from Nazareth in Galilee, but he's far more. It was Jesus the Messiah, not Jesus just the prophet. He was sent from God, not just from Nazareth. You don't get to minimize who Jesus really is out of convenience. But then you got the Pharisees, who, by the way, probably had the most accurate response of all the crowds. How's that for curious? Because he was a threat. Mark chapter 11, Luke chapter 19, John chapter 12, and Mark chapter 11, 18, the Jewish leaders are seeking how to destroy Jesus. Why? Here's what it says. Because they were afraid of him, for all the multitude was astonished at his teaching. Didn't say responding, but just astonished. He's amazing. John chapter 12 said, the world has gone after him. We've done no good. Look at how they're responding to Jesus. They don't even like what we do. The only group who truly understand what was going on that day in Jerusalem, because their problem was not that they could not believe, but they would not believe. Jesus was a threat to their lifestyle. When I was a junior in college, I had a semantics professor who challenged me about Genesis chapter 11, about the theories of language origin that came out of one language. And I said, okay, you give me three upper division units and I'll write a paper. He said, okay. I worked 6 months on the paper. We were first name basis. I said, Jack, only on one condition. If I convince you that the book of Genesis is accurate on all languages coming from one, will you let me tell you about the gospel? He said, yes, I will. True story. So I did that paper and I worked very hard on it. I got a lot of help from a lot of seminaries in America. My cause was Jack, not three units. So I finished the paper and he wrote on the top, you get an A, and by the way, you've convinced me that languages, this is a semantics professor, came from one origin. So I went to his office, said, Jack, so now do I get to talk about Jesus? He said, no. I said, why not, Jack? He says, because I'm convinced that the Bible is accurate in Genesis 11. I'm afraid it'll be accurate in Matthew and other places. True story. I said, so what's the problem? He says, because if it's true, I have to change. I've never forgotten, ever, that the first thing that has to happen in a person's life is that they have to be truth seekers. Jack was not. Listen to me carefully. There are a lot of people who are so threatened by Jesus, not because they can't, but because they won't believe in you. Because of what they have to do, if it's real. What they have to change. What they think they have to undo. And that was the response of the crowd. But what about Jesus' response? Have you ever asked the question, I wonder how Jesus felt? It's a worthy thought. Luke 19:41 tells us, and when he approached Jerusalem, he saw the city and wept over it. This is hardly a triumphal entry. Christ's response was not what we'd expect. We picture him beaming with happiness of so many people responding. There were some right and accurate responders, but not many. In fact, he wept. Not only on that day, but the days following, he wept with loud and deep lamentations and sobbing. The emotion, here's the Son of God sobbing. All the while, the crowds are shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna. And the crowds maybe saw him crying, and they thought there were tears of joy, but most likely they didn't notice, because you know what? It was not about Jesus coming into the city. It was about them. So why did he cry? I think he saw the past superficial demonstrations. He saw their unbelieving hearts as they really are. He saw the devastation that was imminent for the city of Jerusalem 40 years from then, 70 AD, when the city was leveled, the temple gone, not one stone. That was promised. In Luke 19, 41 to 44, when he approached Jerusalem, Jesus saw the city and he wept over it, saying, if you had known in this day, even you, the things which make for real peace. But now they've been hidden from your eyes. You're blind, for the days will come upon you when your enemies will throw up a barricade against you and surround you and hem you in on every side, just like the Roman armies did. And they will level you to the ground like they did, and your children within you, and they will not leave in you, talking about the temple now, one stone upon another, because you did not recognize, watch this, the time of your visitation. This was not a triumphal entry, folks. It was a tearful entry, not a pleasure trip, a painful trip. Because that same crowd, we're in the crowd, when Pilate parades this beat-up Son of Man, says, behold the man. What do you want me to do with him? You know what they said. We have no king but Caesar. Crucify him. Jesus had just come into the city like a king. We have no king but Caesar. Kill him. Not save now, Hosanna. Kill him now. Oh, he wept at the grave of his friend Lazarus. He wept in the Garden of Gethsemane when he sheds drops of blood. Let this cup pass from me. He wept coming into Jerusalem, but he also wept on the cross when he said, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, in his home language, his street language, if you will, of Aramaic, my God, why? Why have you forsaken me? This was not a triumphal entry. So then why did he come? Let's look at the reason quickly. It was obvious what Jesus was doing that spring day as he mounted the colt and rode a few miles into a city celebrating Passover, celebrating God's deliverance from bondage. And he was making a public display of himself as the promised Messiah, the true King of Israel, the only Savior of mankind. You know what he was doing, folks? Real simple. I've said this so many times in so many ways. He made himself an issue. See, before this time, he had told his disciples not to tell anybody because the timing wasn't right. Before this time, the people who wanted to make him king had fled from him, but now the timing was right. It was now time to declare to the world who he was, now time to be glorified. New chapter in the life of Christ, the climax of his life on earth, so that this Jesus of Nazareth, though rejected by the Gentiles, rejected by the Jews, remember he came to his own received him not, John tells us, was declaring himself to be the king of the universe, and was now time for the whole world to know it. Time to shake up the world. Pilate recognized that. So you are a king, Pilate said. And Jesus says, now for the first time, it is as you say. And Pilate puts a sign above Jesus' head, King of the Jews, and so he is. So he is. Whether you believe it or accept it or not, so he is. That Jesus came into this city to stir men's hearts because Christ's presence always, always gets our attention unless we're really blind. Verse 18 says, the sound of your thunder was in the whirlpool. The lightnings lit up the world. Thunder and lightning gets our attention. And the earth trembled and shook. I've been in a few earthquakes, and they get your attention, do they not? Psalm 99, verse 1, the Lord reigns. Let the peoples tremble. He's enthroned above the cherubim. Let the earth shake. Why? Because what men build, God will destroy eventually. He's going to shake up your world. He's going to break your daily routine. He's going to make us stand up and take notice. He came into the city to show them that no one can take a neutral position about Christ. Let's face it, if this building started to rumble in an earthquake, none of us would ignore it. You might respond in different ways, but you certainly wouldn't ignore it. And so it is with us. And one has to ask the question, what kind of entry have you made into my life, Jesus? You entered my world, you stirred up my heart, you interrupted my routine, you made yourself an issue, you shook up my life so that I'll make a proper decision as to who you really are. C.S. Lewis, the great apologist, said it this way, either Jesus was a liar, a lunatic, or the Lord. The only choices you have. And those crowds in Jesus' day, they chose to crucify him. And you get to choose. You don't get to crucify him, already been done. But you do get to either welcome him or turn away from him. St. Augustine said it this way, Christ is not valued at all unless he's valued above all. So quickly, my time is running here, but I want to tell you, I have two other newspapers in my collection. One of them is the Honolulu Star Bulletin, dated December the 7th, 1941, that day that will live on in history and in infamy, remember? Quiet Sunday morning. Pearl Harbor came under attack. And the headline reads, War. Is that not a perfect description of your life and my life? We're at war with ourselves, we're at war with others, but James also says that we're at war with God. Remember in James 4 when he says, friendship with the world is hostility? The Greek word means at war with God. Some of us are at war with God. We're at war. But then I have another, the Philadelphia Inquirer, dated August 15, 1945. That's the day World War II ended. And the headline reads, Peace. Perfect description of our lives when we trust in Christ. Because the war is over. I still to this day remember when the war was over in my heart. I can't say I changed so dramatically in the days after I accepted Christ, but I can tell you I knew peace. I knew peace like never before. The war was over. Printed in the upper left-hand corner of this newspaper says this, Let us thank God to Almighty God for this blessed peace restored to a war-torn world. And a grateful people offer devout thanksgivings. Is the war over for you? Time to thank him. Would you pray with me? As your heads are bowed, let me just pray with us a little bit of an altar call of sorts. And to say to you right now, in the quietness of this moment, hear Jesus getting your attention. He might even be shouting, loudly shouting with his creation and reminders of his power. Or shouting inside your hearts with a conscience that's saying, No, I'm holy, and you need to be holy too. His providence around us that's shouting that God is so good. His word before us shouting to us that he is everything he said he is. And even his people around us today hopefully shouting that he really is their Savior and Lord. God is shouting. God is getting your attention. Don't ignore it today. God's people said, Amen. Thank you so much.
Please stand as we sing. There was a moment when the lights went out, when death had claimed its victory. King of love had given up his life. The darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners. For every curse his blood atoned. Final breath and it was finished, but not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake and the veil was torn. What sacrifice was made as the heavens rose. All hail the Savior.
come bow before the King of Kings. Let every tongue confess that he is Lord. Lift up your shout. Let us join with all of heaven singing, holy, singing, holy, cry out, holy, singing, holy. All hail King Jesus, all hail the Lord of heaven and earth, all hail King Jesus, all hail the Savior of the world.
Please take your seats. After our service today, we're going to invite those of you that need prayer to meet with our pastoral staff on either side. You can also, if you're listening online, just contact us through our webpage. Or you can fill out a registration card here. Maybe God is shaking you up. Maybe God needs to shake up somebody in your life and you want us to pray with you and for them. We don't want to leave a message like this and ignore the one who deserves our attention. Amen. The other thing is, I do want to invite you to come on out tonight. It's not about me. It's not about my teaching. Really, it's about a miracle God is doing beyond what we ever imagined or thought. I'll tell you those stories tonight. But I say that because we're excited about new technologies, but we're also needing the wisdom and the prayers of God's people as we step into a world that we never planned on stepping into at such volume. So please come out tonight. But then also, I want to invite any of you who are public school, private school, or homeschool educators to stand right now, please, all of you. Administrators, teachers, I don't care if you're a janitor, you're involved with education. Here at Campus Bible Church, we consider you more than just educators, but missionaries. And we're grateful for you. And just as we lay hands in the spirit of Acts chapter 14 and other places as they laid hand on missionaries, all right, we do so with you. And commit to pray with you, to pray for you, to support you in any way that we can. We're blessed with a lot of talented educators here, but we also know how laws are changing and how the challenge is that in some senses you're going to what might even be considered an unbelieving context, much like sending you to a foreign country where atheism is the order of the day. So I say that to you to say we know, not specifically, but God has called you to this place. He hasn't called us, he's called you. But he's called us to support you, to champion you, to pray with you, to surround you in any way. We offer the services. We have many educators who are highly skilled educators and counselors as well. If you need help from them with your own personal issues, some of them know the law backwards and forwards and can help you with to what level you can share the gospel, what will you listen, you what you have, as you can live your faith before them, even if you can't preach the faith to them. Live your faith before your students, before the administrators, before the staff, before the parents. Live your faith before them and let the light of the gospel shine in you and through you. And that's our prayer for you. Might I dedicate you now for that. Father, thank you for these precious people, for the skill you've given them as educators, for the degrees, of course, and the extra course of instruction. But more than that, for the passion to educate, to train, to equip, be it math or English or science, it doesn't matter, God, because in the midst of that is you. You're behind all of those things, the Lord of the universe. So I pray for them, for wisdom beyond their experience. I pray that this be a great year, whether it's a great year administratively or educationally, but a great year in terms of impact of the gospel through their lives. God, open the door, I pray, of opportunity to fellow students, to fellow teachers, to fellow staff, to fellow parents. And God, we lay them before you now in the spirit of the book of Acts, and then we send them out to you waiting for a good report of what only you can do. And we lay them before you now in Jesus' name, and God's people said, amen. Let's give them a hand, and would you stand with me, please? And now let's close our time. All of us stand, please. And Father, we now thank you for this day that you've given us. for not only those that are here in this auditorium and not only those that are listening online, but our Palm audience as well, that are out there in their own worship time together. I pray for that time of study and worship. God, we're blessed to be a church family that is endeavoring to love you more, to serve you better, and to wait for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Put a second coming passion in all of our hearts. These days are short. Don't blind us. Don't let us be blinded by the shortcomings of others. Let us look to you, the author and the finisher of our faith, in Jesus' name. And God's people said, amen. God bless you. We'll see you next Lord's Day.